You may be seated, and if you would, open your Bible, please, to the book of Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6. My subject today, first things first. First things first. Before you begin your day, pray. Before you sing, pray. Before I preach, I must pray. Before you engage in any activity, pray. Jesus said men ought always pray, and he said that we would never to quit praying, and Jesus was a man of prayer. He gave us that great example. And as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said, Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. And so in Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, we start with this model prayer. Jesus said, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. All right, we're waiting on them to catch up with us. He said, pray this way, Matthew 6 and 9. After this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Every year, people make New Year's resolutions. And they do that because they realize that there are great deficiencies and great needs in their lives. What will bring the needed change? What can you do in your life to affect that change? Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. So as we seek God through the world of prayer. That's how we seek God. My subject this morning, first things first. Let us pray. Brother Philip, would you come and just bless this message, please? Hallelujah. My thanks stirred in my spirit. I reached over there and had him pray a prayer of agreement with me earlier. Bless the people.
Father God, thank you for your word today, a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. Lord, help us to be attentive unto it now, to hide its secrets in our hearts that we might not sin against you. Bless and anoint our brother as he brings to us your word, as he expounds it to us. Holy Ghost, speak through him. Speak to us this day that you would have us to know. Be glorified in all of our lives in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You might be thinking, well, what can you bring new about the Lord's Prayer? Well, we'll just see what the Lord has to say to us, okay? So many times we are faced with almost insurmountable problems, question marks which cannot be erased, mountains that cannot be moved, situations that never seem to change. People have all types of problems. They face divorce, broken homes, children on drugs, and children on alcohol. They face problems in their finances and in many other areas of their life, and dark, dismal distress and despair. It comes over people. Suicidal demons begin to talk to them. Jobs being eliminated. Homes being split up. All kind of things that we face in this world. And we know that there are thousands of people every day that face some of these problems that I am talking about. So my question is, do people understand the transforming power of prayer? If so, why do so many people neglect the world of prayer? You'd be surprised at the people who go through life and fight and cry and face all types of darkness and all kinds of problems, and they never think about prayer. Do they even know that there's a God in heaven who hears and who answers prayer? Yet, some people, they never give any thought to prayer. They just walk through the darkness, and they let the devil destroy their homes, their finances, and their health. And they never realize that God is approachable and that God is persuadable. I said, your God, your Father, he is approachable and he is persuadable. Amen. There is somebody bigger than your problems. There is somebody bigger than your circumstances. And God has the power to open doors. He can open a door that no man can close, and he can close a door that no man can open. And God has the power to transform all the circumstances and all the problems that you're dealing with in life right now. Somebody go on and praise him. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God is approachable, and you can turn to God. And God will help you, and God will give you a miracle, and God will give you wisdom, and God will give you the knowledge to get through that situation that you're facing. I have people all the time, and I've told them, I'll pray for you. They say, well, I'm not a Christian. I say, well, I am. But my question is, do you think God will hear the person that's not a Christian? Do you think? And they ask me, do you think God will hear me? Well, he's God, and he can hear anybody he wants to. I remember when I was wondering if I'd ever see the morning. And I said, oh, God, when I get home, I'll serve you and my whole family. I didn't even have a family. But God heard my cry. God looked on the intent of my heart. It was 17, 18 years later when I gave my heart to the Lord. But God is God. He can hear the cry of anybody he wants to. And if he can hear your cursing, certainly he can hear your cry. God is a good God. And he has given us some exceeding great and precious promises. And those promises he's given to the lost also if they will call upon him. Look at this. I love this. Jeremiah 33:3. This is God's number. Jeremiah 33:3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. And look at this, Jeremiah 32:17. Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. Hallelujah. And Jeremiah's God is my God. And if Jesus is your Lord, Jeremiah's God is your God. And there is nothing, nothing, nothing too hard for him. Somebody go and praise the Lord. Glory to God. I love all of that. And I love this. Look at what Isaiah said in Isaiah 45:22. God said, look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none other. Oh, hallelujah. We serve the true and the living God. See, God is talking to the saved and the unsaved alike in that scripture. Look unto me, all the ends of the earth, and be saved, for I am God and there's none else. He's saying, look unto me, call unto me. And then Jesus said, come unto me. You see, God will hear the call. He will hear the cry of every human heart if they will turn their faith toward heaven and call upon him, because God is approachable. You just need to know that. God loves you. God cares about you. God understands what you're going through. But your need will not change God. Prayers will change God. And God is approachable, and you can get an answer from the throne room of God. Somebody praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, there was a man in the 10th chapter of the book of Acts, and his name was Cornelius. And he was an Italian, and he was a religious man, but he was lost. He was very, very religious. So you can be religious and be lost. And the Bible says he prayed, he gave, he helped build the house of God, and he fasted. And yet, he was not a saved person. He wanted to be saved, and if anybody wants to be saved, God will answer the cry of a desperate heart. Do you know what God did? God sent him an angel. He was a religious man. He was a lost man, but God sent him an angel. And do you know what the angel said? He said, your prayers and your giving have come up as a memorial before God. Now, that didn't save Cornelius. His prayers did not save him. His giving did not save him. And your prayers cannot save you just because you pray. And your giving cannot save you just because you give. But what I want you to understand is this. The angel said, God has been listening to you pray. God has been listening to the cry of your heart. God has been listening to you, and God, he knows every dollar you've given. He knows your heart is reaching out to him. And the angel said, send to Joppa and ask for a man named Simon, whose surname is Peter. He's dwelling over by the seaside at the house of Simon the Tanner. Do you know that God knows each and every detail of everything in your life, and God is watching you, and God is listening for you to cry out to him. Hallelujah. The angel said, go get a man named Peter, and he will tell you words whereby you and all your house shall be saved. You see, he wasn't saved. And angels are not permitted to preach the gospel under the new covenant. If it's ever preached, it must be preached by a human being, a man or woman. So God will hear the cry of his people. And the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a promise. What an incredible promise. Do we really feel the cry of the lost, the broken, those in despair? Are we willing to pray and set the course through fasting? Are we willing to put our family members on the altar? Are we willing to cry out to God, get in the church, get involved, and be faithful to what God has called us to do? Or do we just want to have a religious pretense? God knows. God understands. I might could con my wife, but I promise you one thing. I don't want to con her. I can't con God. Amen. I remember when I first got saved, I had some tremendous need in my life, and I was struggling with some great things that I needed deliverance from, but I was saved. And I said, God, I can't con you. So I just will to go on and be honest with you. I need help. Help me, God. And he did. He heard my desperate cry. He heard my cry of destitution when I wasn't saved. And after I got saved, he heard my cry of destitution. He heard my cry. He's no respecter of person. He'll hear your cry if you'll call out to God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. He said, look unto me and be saved. Look unto me and live all the ends of the earth. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Glory to God. What a wonderful promise. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to pay for it. It's been paid in full. When Jesus hung upon that cross, he cried, it is finished. And the claims of justice were satisfied. And God's gavel came down and said, anyone and everyone that calls upon the name of my son Jesus, they shall be saved. Aren't you glad to be saved today? Aren't you glad that you're in the house of God, that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life, and you know that you know, and you're sure that you're sure, and you can feel the Holy Ghost right now touching the strings of your heart and encouraging you to press on into more of God. Hallelujah. God is a great God. But in the text I read, Jesus is talking about covenant people. He's talking to Christians now, to the church. And that's what I want to preach about in the rest of this message. That how Christians can change things through the power of prayer. Christians, you and me, we can change things through the power of prayer. How can we do that? Because we're calling out to a God who is the God of the impossible. Oh, I love to see people get blessed. I love to see people's prayers answered. I love to see the miracle working power of God. And I'm willing to pray with you. I'm willing to fast. I'm willing to call out to God and study the Word so I can bring you something that'll stir your innermost beings. Hallelujah. Did you ever notice down in the prayer that Jesus gave? It says, give us, forgive us, lead us, and deliver us. That's the progression. Give us, forgive us, lead us, deliver us. And that's where most people want to start with, though. They just cry, gimme, gimme, gimme. Gimme. I heard one man say, my name is Jimmy. I'll take what you gimme. But Jesus taught these principles of prayer so we would know how to approach God. God is approachable. And I'm talking about changing your world, the atmosphere, the conditions in your life by the transforming power of prayer. I don't know what kind of situation you're in. I don't know what kind of problems you're facing. All I know is this. My Bible says my God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all I could ever ask or think, according to the power of God that's working in us. And I'm willing to seek Him and search for Him because I've seen Him do so much. But I say, God, that's so much more. And I'm entering the new year with a spirit of expectation. And I release that spirit of expectation upon you. Hallelujah. That the Holy Ghost will stir this whole church, this whole body. And He'll begin to stir us to where we press on into Him who loved us and gave Himself for us. Go on and praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Listen to me. If people don't pray, God won't work. God does not answer just because there is a need. God answers a prayer. And if you will read your Bible, you will find out that God waits upon man before God ever moves. Now, over in the 12th chapter of the book of Acts, it says that King Herod, he reached out and he had James, the brother of John, arrested. And Herod killed him with the sword. Right there in your Bible. And the church mourned and mourned for James because he was a leader. He was a dignitary. He was an apostle in the early church. And then the Bible says, they took Peter also and put him in prison in the innermost part. And they planned to bring Peter out, and they were going to kill Peter also. But the Bible says, but the church prayed. Put this up there, Acts 12:25. Look at that. Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Oh, I want to pray in church like that. Oh, do you know how much I need your prayer? Do you have any idea the demons that I face? Do you have any idea the battles that I fight as I just live my life out daily, ministering to the hearts of broken, fragmented, crying, dying, sighing people? Do you know that if you are called into what I do, then God will put it into your heart and He will put compassion in your heart to feel what others feel. Sometimes I just can't shake it off. I'm a joyous Christian. But Jesus was full of joy, praise God, but He was touched with compassion. And today, in His high priestly ministry, at the right hand of His majesty on high, the Bible says He's touched with the feeling of our infirmities. He's touched with the feeling of our needs. But He doesn't just answer need. He answers those that pray. Acts 12:25, Peter therefore was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Pray, pray, pray. Hallelujah. Pray. You may be thinking, well, why didn't God save James? Well, nobody prayed that God would save him. Well, I thought God loved him. Well, nobody prayed. God did love him. Nobody intervened. And God does not intervene in human affairs unless somebody prays. So the church prayed. And Peter was going to die the next morning. But God, in answer to their prayer, he sent an angel from the glory world. Can you imagine Peter lying there and this angel walks in? Can you imagine he's just come from the throne room of God? He's probably glowing, probably 10 foot tall. I don't know. My imagination starts to run wild on things like that. But he walks into that place. Amen. He walked through the prison gates. He walked through the bars. He walked over to where Peter was. And Peter was sleeping on a pillar of peace. Hallelujah. And he popped him on the side. He said, "Wake up, Peter. We're getting out of this place. Let me tell you how much a word from God can do for you. While I'm preaching, God can give you a prophetic word." Peter, he met Jesus in John chapter 21, and he asked him, he was telling him about his future. And he said, "Well, what about John?" And Jesus said, "Don't be concerned about John, Peter. Follow me. Don't get your eyes on people. Get your eyes on Jesus." Ha ha, shakabohu, shakaramuhu shataya. Glory to God. And Jesus gave Peter a word. He said, "When you're old," he said, "you're going to be led somewhere you don't want to go." And the Bible says, "This spake he of his death." God had told Peter, Peter's in the prison. They planning to kill him. He said, "You can't die until you're an old man." Peter had a promise from God. Woo! Hallelujah. He's asleep on a pillow. "I can't die. God promised me something. I'm going to walk this thing out. They can lock me up. They can do what they want to. But my God will come. He'll come to me." He's praying. The church is praying. The whole church is praying. And God sent that angel, smote him on the side. And he walked out of that place a free man, delivered. And you can walk out too, free and delivered. By the power, the power of God. Hallelujah. What if the church had not prayed for Peter? People are saying, "Oh, my child is on alcohol. My child is on drugs. Oh, my family, you don't understand. My family's about to split up. My finances, they're about to go bankrupt." Listen, folks, there's a God in heaven, and he hears and he listens. Hallelujah. I remember when Jessica was in school out in Idaho, and I was going through a great struggle at that time with my health. My body was mending, and I needed all the rest I could get. I didn't go tell people, you know, how weak I was. I just talked to my God. Hallelujah. Look at me now. Woo! My body was just glory. Woo! Makes me want to shout. Ha ha. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. From my heart, there's no doubt about it. I'm going to sing and shout it. Thank you, Jesus. From my heart, the devil's mad and I am glad. 'Cause he lost a soul that he thought he had. Thank you, Jesus, from my heart. Well, there's no doubt about it. I'm gonna sing and shout it. Thank you, Jesus, from my heart. Somebody gonna praise him. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I needed all the rest I could get. I thank God for my praying wife. I have a wife that is a gift from God. Read your Bible. "He that findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtaineth favor of the Lord." Hallelujah. And God woke my wife Teresa up at 3 a.m. in the morning. And she felt a great need to pray for our daughter Jessica, who was out in Idaho. And she prayed and she prayed. And she prayed in the Holy Ghost until she got some relief. And she asked me the next day, "Did the Lord wake you up to pray for Jessica?" I said, "No, I slept like a baby." And this thing went on for 3 nights. And we found out later that Jessica, she had taken one of her friends to the top of the mountain. And when she came off of that mountaintop, she oversteered in a curve. Her car went into a spin. And that mountain, it had a drop of several thousand feet. If you were to go up on that mountain and look down at the river was very small as you looked at it, but it was a huge river. And just before she plummeted over that mountainside, God sent an angel, and that vehicle somehow miraculously stopped. And God spared my baby's life because of a praying mother. Oh, mothers, thank God for mothers that know how to pray. Thank God. Hallelujah. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. Thank God for a wife. Thank God for a church that will pray and who can move the hand of God. Our God is approachable, and prayer changes things. But we want to start with gimme, gimme, gimme. But Jesus said, no, there are four other things that you need to do before you get down to the business of asking. First of all, he said, when you pray, first point, first of all, when you pray, you are talking to your Father. Do you understand that? When you pray, you are talking to your Father, our Father, which art in heaven. You're not talking to a stranger, our Father. You're not talking to somebody who doesn't know you. You're not talking to someone that you have a casual acquaintance with, but you are talking to your relative, to your Father. Hallelujah. You're saying, our Father, when you say that, you're saying, thank God, I'm born again. Hallelujah. Of his own will, he begat us by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. And it doesn't matter what type of denomination you belong to, Methodist, Baptist, Episcopalian, Lutheran, Presbyterian, Catholic, or Pentecostal, whatever. If you have Jesus as your Lord, then God is your Father. Hallelujah. Thank God. God is my Father. Jesus is my Lord. My name is in the book. It doesn't matter what church I affiliate myself with, or what church anybody in the body of Christ affiliates themselves with, or denomination. Praise God. If you've been born again, God is your Father. And the church world needs to understand that. Jesus prayed in the 17th chapter of John. He said, Father, I pray that they may be one, even as we are one. I and thou, and thou and me, that they may be one in us. And the glory that thou hast given me, thou may give unto them. Somebody go and praise. Paul got the revelation. He said, it's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Woo! When you pray, you're talking to your Father. Hallelujah. Our Father, which art in heaven, there's another world, and it's called heaven. A land of no sorrow, no tears, no pains. And when you rise up in the world of prayer, you are invited to come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain mercy and find grace to help in your time of need. And God is touched, church. He is touched by your feelings. He is touched. He cares for you. He loves you. You're praying to your Father, which is in heaven. And you got to realize that no matter how hard things are, that you're on your way to heaven. Point number two, which art in heaven? My Father, which art in heaven. You have to realize you are taking your prayer to heaven. Hallelujah. Where are you taking your prayer? You're taking it into another world. Amen. And you're talking to your Father. And you got to realize that no matter how hard things get down here, you are on your way to heaven. Your name is in the book. Hallelujah. That's where my daddy is. My mother's there. My brother Howell is there. My sister Carolyn is there. There are other family members there. Thank God we've got relatives on the other side. All of us do. And there's a land there of no more death, no more pain, no more tears, no more sorrows. Heaven, happy home above. Heaven, land of peace and love. Oh, it makes me feel like traveling on. Heaven, eternal. Heaven, supernal. I'm so glad that it's real. Since childhood, I heard of a heaven. I wondered if it could be true, if there could be mansions eternal up there somewhere beyond the blue. I wonder, do people think it really go there? Then one day sweet Jesus came in, and I caught a vision of heaven. My soul with all heaven did blend. Heaven, happy home above. Heaven, land of peace and love. Oh, it makes me feel like traveling on. Heaven, eternal. Heaven, supernal. Well, I'm so glad that it's real. Yes, I'm so glad that it's real. Hallelujah. We're talking to our Father, which is in heaven. And then you got to think about the name that you're praying in. God has given Jesus a name above every name. And we don't take our righteousness, and we don't take our denominational name, and we don't take our family name. We bear the name of Jesus, and we come to our Father in the name of Jesus. Demons and hell trembles, and heaven rejoices. Hallelujah. We come in that name, and demons are driven away, and angels are loose. That's the power of prayer. We're asking for help from another world. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Then thirdly, we're praying for God's kingdom to come. Hallelujah. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. See, when you approach God, you ought to think about his kingdom. Woo! You used to be in the kingdom of darkness, but now you're in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. And you represent God down here on earth. Our citizenship is in heaven, and we're looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. And fourthly, is the part where so many people miss it. Thy will be done. Jesus said, thy will be done. He prayed it in the garden. Father, not as I will, but thy will be done. If you want big things from God, surrender your entire life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Before you get down to give me, ask God to talk to you about his will. You say, well, I want God to hear me, but are you willing? Are you even interested in God's will for your life? Do you realize that God has a plan for your life? And one of the greatest things you could ever do is to surrender to the Lord, get saved, and then surrender to his lordship. God has a purpose for you living on this earth. And none of us are to drift along aimlessly and recklessly through life. God wants us to know his will. And when you pray, talk to God, not only about heaven, not only about his kingdom, but talk to him about his will. God, I want to do your will. Tell him that. Thousands of people, they want God to give them miracles, yet they don't want to do God's will. First things first. And I believe after today, you will want to surrender to the Lordship and to the will of God so that you can get your prayers answered. And then we get down to the part where it says, give me, forgive me, lead me, deliver me. That's the progression. Go look at it. Give us this day. Forgive us our debts. Lead me not into temptation. Deliver me from all evil. Give me, forgive me, lead me, deliver me. Sure, you have great needs, and sometimes it takes a miracle from God to bring that thing to pass. But God will listen when you say, Father, oh, my Father. Father, now that I have entered your will, give me. And then you can pray the prayer and say, Lord, since you're going to give me, forgive me. Lord, forgive me as I forgive those that trespass against me. Forgive me, Lord. I have my flaws. I have my shortcomings. but you know the thought and intent of my heart. Forgive me, O Lord. You see, God will forgive you. He will give to you, and then he will forgive you. He gives us salvation, and then he forgives us. We have an advocate with the Father. Hallelujah. And if we sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. He'll give to you, and then he'll forgive you. Then the Bible says you can go on the way it says, lead me. If you've got his will in your heart and you're in his kingdom, if you feel with the thoughts of God, not only will he give you, but he will forgive you and he will lead you. We are all like sheep. Matter of fact, we are sheep. Jesus is the good shepherd and we need direction. I know I do. And without Jesus as our shepherd and as our Lord, we will never make it. We need his guidance. We need his leadership. We need his help. Not my will, but thy will be done. So, Lord, give me. Lord, forgive me. Lord, lead me. And then there's the last one. Lord, deliver me. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And if you'll take that prayer in that progressive way, when you get down to deliver me, God will move all of heaven to deliver you. Hallelujah. When you pray like that, God's army is put on alert. I mean, they are ready to go into battle. Angels will move in mighty power. Demons will tremble and scatter and run when you pray like that. Hallelujah. Glory to God. The world of prayer, the world that moves the hand of God, the world that brings blessings from the glory world into our world. Seek him, hallelujah. Call upon him and watch God move. Surrender everything to his lordship, hallelujah. You know, I love what Jeremiah said, Jeremiah 32:17. Ah, Lord God. Look at that, Jeremiah 32:17. Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heavens and the earth. Behold, that word means to just stop, look, listen, ponder, think about who your God is. Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arms. I love this. And there is nothing too hard for thee. See, our God is able and willing to do exceeding abundantly all that we could ever ask or think when we approach him in that divine order right there. When I think about the power of prayer, not only is God approachable, but God is persuadable. God is persuadable. He's a sovereign God. He can do anything he wants to, anytime he wants to. But God, your Father, he is persuadable. Hallelujah. Glory to God. God told Isaiah, said, you go tell Hezekiah. Tell him to set his house in order. Hezekiah, you shall die and not live. Those are the words of Almighty God. You shall die and not live. Set your house in order. But God is approachable and God is persuadable. And the Bible says Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and he cried out to God and he prayed and he touched heaven. And the Lord stopped Isaiah before he got out of the palace courtyard. And he said, go back and tell Hezekiah, I've heard his cry. I've seen his tears. He's not going to die. He's going to live. And I have added 15 years to his life. Somebody go and praise God. Hallelujah. I'm talking about first things first and changing things by the power of prayer. You want another example? Sodom and Gomorrah. The angel came to Abraham and said, we're going to destroy this city. And he starts intervening. He said, God, will you spare the city for 50 righteous people? Yes, I'll do it. Will you do it for 40? Yes, I'll do it. Will you do it for 30? Yes, I'll do it. Will you do it for 20? Yes, I'll do it. Will you do it for 10? God said, I'll do it if I can find 10 righteous people there. and Abraham left off praying. What if Abraham had prayed again? The city was destroyed, but God brought those righteous out. That's a picture of the rapture. How are you living your life? Are you rapture ready? Hallelujah. That's what this year's about. Expectation. Expecting. Pastor Ricky, he alluded to it. This could be the year. This could be the day. This could be the hour. Hallelujah. Live like he could come any moment and work like he's not coming today. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm talking about first things first. And when the report says, no hope, no hope, we got another report in the Bible. Hallelujah. And Teresa and I have to bring her into this because she's my prayer partner. We watch God move. We watch God change things. We watch the miraculous in our family. I told even yesterday, I said, our marriage is a miraculous marriage. Our life is a miraculous life. We serve a miraculous God. We have a miraculous home. We drive miracle cars. We have miracle children. Everything God has given to me, I was so broken and so fragmented. I encourage you to know this. God is approachable, and God is persuadable, and God will hear your cry. Hallelujah. And he will move mountains. He will divide rivers. He will deliver you from the fiery furnace. He will deliver you from the lion's den. Our God is not only able, but our God is willing. So look to God today and expect your miracle from him. Let us stand. Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord, my soul.
I want everybody that can to come to the altar. I didn't preach this message to watch people walk out. I preached this message so you could come talk to your God. So you know who you're talking to. So you know the divine order of how to approach him. Oh, my soul, worship you. Let's come and talk to our Father. Our Father, which art in heaven.